Getting a scientific article published is a very long process. It can be explained that editors and reviewers of commercial journals, they are often publicly funded scientists, which among the voluntary and free work for commercial publishers, they have other duties for which they are getting their salaries from taxpayers. Does this long publishing process look old-fashioned in highly digitalized era with a lot of data that needs to be analyzed very fast and efficient? Let's try to understand it better together with German scientist Björn Brems. This is the third part of four of our interview with him. My name is Stefaniia, and you're watching Open Science TV. Zen Faulkes, neurobiologist from the University of Texas, together with his undergraduate student Jessica Murph, studied local sand crabs. During 3 years, they collected enough of data to write an article and submit it to the journal, the Southwestern Naturalist. So Zen submitted a paper on the 22nd of August 2011, but the confirmation about submission he got only a month after, on the 26th of September 2011. Only on the 24th of May 2012 he got answers from peer reviewers. He sent back revisions 1 week later, and only in November 2013 he got an email that the article will be published in December 2013. But in the web it was available only on the 4th of June 2014. It took almost 3 years to publish an article compared to 2 years of doing the research and sand crabs. Unfortunately, I even not able to check out this article as it is paywalled for $10. Of course, this case is extreme, but sometimes even 2, 3, 4 months are crucial not only for scientists' career, but also for the impact and relevance of this research for the society that actually paid for it. Björn, it seems that all this process of traditional submitting and publishing of an academic paper to the commercial journal is very complicated. Can you explain how does it work? And, for example, after the researcher is done with the suitable amount of results to provide important conclusions, and he/she wants to let other scientists and actually other people to know about these results, what is going to be next?
So they sit down, the researchers sit down and write a manuscript. And this is already where it's, from a today's perspective, becomes very weird, is that you don't provide the data and the code together in a way such that that the reader can look through the data. But we're very used to many websites where we can change the graphs, where we can mouse over a graph and get information about the graph, these sort of things. This all does not exist in scientific publishing. In scientific publishing, we just take one picture of a graph that we decide how it looks like. So we look at this part or at this part. We don't ever show everything. And this we put into a document and then we send it to a publisher. And there are about 35,000 scholarly journals right now, something like that. And by that, I mean that they are peer-reviewed. And what does that peer review mean? Peer review means that there is an editor sitting there at the journal who is either a volunteer, would be like me, someone who on the side does editing for a certain journal, looks at the manuscript and says either, for instance, oh, I'm a cancer research journal, or I edit for a cancer research journal. This is high energy physics. This is not, you picked the wrong journal and they reject it right away, in a very simple example. Or they look at it and say, okay, this looks actually like decent cancer research. Let me send it to these two or three colleagues that are experts in this particular cancer. And then they look over the manuscript. Also, again, they usually don't have access to the raw data. They don't have access to any code or any other important aspects of the work. They look at it, they try to find out, okay, are the methods written in a way that I could reproduce it? are the statements of the authors backed up by the data? So for instance, if the authors say, oh, we cured this cancer, and the data only show that the cancer shrunk by 50%, then they go and say, no, you can't say that. Your data only show that it's, 50%. It's not cured. You're not, your animals or whatever it is that is in the paper doesn't hold what you're saying. And so on. And then these colleagues write some comments. And again, they don't do this in an interactive way. So what the way one would do this today is you have the document on your screen and you write comments to these individual things, you make suggestions, and then the authors would say, yes, I like this suggestion. No, let's discuss. I don't understand what is here. You discuss the suggestion and then you fix something. And then when everything is done, you go to the editor and say, hey, everything's clear. Now you can publish it. But of course, this is not how it happens. In fact, what the reviewers do is they write some sort of email where they refer, with page number and line number or something like that, where they refer to the section that they're talking about, maybe quoting it. So they write a real letter, just like you used to do in paper, and send it back to the editor, who then takes all of these letters, tries to summarize what they mean, and sends them anonymously. So he takes the names out of the people who reviewed it and sends them back to the authors, saying either, I accept it as it is, you don't have to change anything, or you have minor revisions. That means that you have to change something in the text. For instance, we reduced cancer's volume by 50% and not cured it. Or three major revisions, which means you have to do additional experiments usually, or you reject it, say, no matter what you do, we're not going to publish it. And then the authors resubmit. Well, if it's not accepted, then they resubmit either to the same journal or to one of the other 34,999 that are 34,999 journals that are left. And this is done usually until it is published somewhere. Because if you have 35,000 to choose from, eventually you'll end up with one that will publish your work.
Okay, so it seems that this publishing process is stuck in the last century. Besides being long, it is also inefficient. And in addition, I have an impression that articles, they're only comprising like positive results, which are easy to sell to journals. In the same time, it could be a strategy or hypothesis which didn't work for this research and it was not described in the article. So let's imagine other scientists working in the same subject. They didn't know that this experiment didn't work, so they will spend their time and public money for literally nothing.
So this could be, right? This depends on the authors, and it depends on the topic. Sometimes you need to describe something that didn't work to motivate why you're doing what you're doing. So for instance, if a very straightforward experiment that anybody would do didn't work, you'll have to explain why you do the complicated experiment. Because everyone is going to say, why did you do such a complicated experiment when you could simply do this, right? And then you have to show why you didn't do this, because for some reason, this didn't give the results that it should have and it didn't work. And so you had to do a different experiment. And so sometimes sometimes there's no other way. But very often what you describe is something that people only publish the results where what they did actually worked. And by actually worked, one has to really think hard what that means. And this gets confused in discussion a little bit. Actually works means that in this case, a positive result versus a negative result. It doesn't mean that the experiment didn't work in such as I wanted to measure temperature and I got energy, right? Then the experiment didn't work. I want to have degrees and I get kilojoule. This is not what I want. I want degrees, right? Or I want to study how to cure cancer, but the mice that I'm using, they don't develop cancer. So that means the experiment didn't work. And those are technical things that you usually don't publish, and I think it's okay. Right? If you don't publish that you couldn't try your drug on this mouse strain because they never develop cancer, you would only publish this if there's a big literature in saying that these mice, they develop cancer, right? But if you have a new mouse strain and you think, oh, I treat them with this, in this mouse strain they develop cancer, and then in this mouse strain they don't, and what you're really interested in is how to treat the cancer and not how mice develop cancer, then I think it's perfectly fine not to publish this. So this is really important distinction between experiments that don't work and experiments that do work, but they don't have an effect. So for instance, your mice do develop cancer, and you do treat them, you do everything right, and this treatment is something that should work according to your hypothesis, but the cancer doesn't care about your hypothesis, and it still keeps growing. And then very often, people don't publish this. The reason why they don't publish this is something that my thesis advisor, Martin Heisenberg, called or described with a sentence, the world is full of non-elephants. Which of course means that if you look behind the window, you'll probably not be too surprised to see that here in Germany, there are no elephants outside, right? This is not surprising. And so there's no need to go around and saying, hey, in Regensburg, Bavaria, there are no elephants on the streets. This is not something you would find on the newspaper, in the newspapers. And so what is in the news, of course, is when you do find elephants here in Germany on the street, this will be in the news. And so the elephants on the street is what gets published and is what many journals are interested in. Now, in science, though, things are a little bit different. So if you would go to a place where you normally find elephants and then you don't see them there, then it's actually worthwhile. You wouldn't probably say it in the news. But in science, you would do that. So if you have a hypothesis that makes sense, and you have a hypothesis that can be derived from previous data, and you test that hypothesis. And this is the equivalent of, you know, going to a place where you have lots of elephants, like a national park in Africa, and then the elephants are not there. Like, or you find elephant dung, and then the elephants are not there. Then you wonder, okay, what is it? Was my hypothesis wrong? Maybe this is not elephant dung, maybe this is hippo dung. And I should have looked in the water and not on land. And because, but until then, you know, you think, well, it's straightforward. I have these big dung heaps. They look like elephant dung. I should be looking for elephants. And so in science, it's actually really important in many cases to say that your experiment did work, but it did not have the effect that you expected. Now, there's one small caveat to this straightforward negative results are important. And that is something that also gets very little discussion. What can happen is that if you say there are no elephants there, then people stop looking, can stop looking there. And it may just be that you didn't look in the right way. And so one potential danger, and that is very difficult to estimate how big that is, one potential danger is that if you publish all the things that did not have an effect, then if it's something that is very difficult to do and you need maybe 100 people to try it until someone finds a way for it to work, it may be that only 99 try it and the 100th person that would have gotten it to work reads the 99 reports and says, 99 people have tried this. There's no way I'm going to succeed. There's no way I'm going to find the elephants there because 99 people already looked. But there may be elephants there because in science, we don't know. So I think it is important to publish negative data, but there is, as with many things, there is a risk of a detrimental side effect, and that is psychological. Is if you say, I've looked and I didn't find it, then maybe other people will stop looking.
Yes, there is another problem. When these positive results, which were like finally published, they were often found to be not reproducible. Is lack of reproducibility making part of current problems in academia?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, the hunt for positive results, the hunt for things that show that your hypothesis actually was correct, is indeed a problem. because you may be wrong, right? You may have the wrong binoculars looking for the elephant, and the rhinoceros may have looked like an elephant because you only saw its rear end and you didn't know what magnification you had. And it looked from behind, it looked like the in the tall grass, it looked like the rear end of an elephant, when in fact it was a rhinoceros. And so now people think, oh, there's elephants in this national park, when in fact there aren't any. And so this again, if you would publish the magnification of your binoculars and the place where you were automatically without having to do it yourself, then people could check right away and could say, hey, look, there's something wrong with your setup. This has actually happened to me. When I moved here from my previous employment, I brought some flies with me that we couldn't test in a confocal microscope because the microscope in Berlin where I was broken. So I took them here and tested them here. And because this microscope was new to me, I didn't look too carefully. I just was introduced into the microscope, how it worked. And I generated a video of the brain of these flies where an expression pattern was glowing. So we have these green glowing neurons in this brain and they were spinning around, and I put them on YouTube and saying, hey, I used our new confocal microscope to make this nice image of these flies. And on the same day at 8 PM, a colleague of mine sent me an email saying, there's something wrong with your flies because you say it's these flies, but it doesn't look like that. It looks like these flies. And this indeed was a real massive problem. And it was pure luck that this person saw the YouTube video and alerted me to it. And if we wouldn't have noticed this right away, this would have posed big, big problems and cost us a lot of time. So this was very, very helpful. And so this is a nice example of how good it is to have everything openly and let everybody look at it. And so these things help. But of course, if you don't do that, and if these things occur in journals, then of course you run into the problem that the reviewers, right, they don't have access to these things. I made the mistake. I think these are these flies. I present the experiments. I never show this video. And the reviewers don't see this and think, oh, holy crap, these flies, they are doing these sorts of things. Who would have thought that these flies with these neurons manipulated would do this sort of behavior? And then this gets published and someone else asks me, hey, can you send me these flies? Oh, yeah, here you are. I send them the flies and they find out, oh, those are not the right flies. And then this is really embarrassing. And in a lot of ways, probably this is what happens a lot of times when people make simple mistakes and nobody catches them. And sometimes these mistakes are not simple at all. Sometimes it really takes an expert. Nobody but someone who's steeped in flies and their different transgenic expression patterns, no one would see the difference. I mean, I looked at the video, I generated it, and I didn't pay enough attention, and I did not see the difference. I did not see that this was not the right one. I looked at a few core aspects, and I said, okay, they're okay, that's fine. But there were, you know, essentially little spots and lines that I didn't see that they were missing. And my colleague saw that right away and alerted me that I didn't pay enough attention. And so this is not this is an easy mistake. For someone who doesn't know fly anatomy, this is not a very easy mistake to make, right? And so some of these mistakes are difficult to find and require a lot of scrutiny. And so it may be that one person looks over it, finds no problem. Another person looks over it, finds no problem. A third person looks over it and finds no problem. And only the fifth, sixth, or seventh person actually finds that problem that the other people haven't seen. So the more people can scrutinize what we have done, the better our science will be.
So your story about YouTube video and wrong flies, it is actually an example of open peer review, but in traditional scientific publishing process, besides that reviewers are not aware about the background and raw data of your experiment, in theory, they can be your potential concurrents. They can prevent your article to be published in this journal and stay anonymous. Is the anonymity of the peer review a big problem now?
This also happens. I mean, this is a human enterprise and people do human things. I think the anonymity in peer review is both a blessing and a curse. It's a blessing for people who find themselves at risk from that person they're criticizing. So, for instance, if you don't know the author, you're a reviewer, you don't know the author very well, and they work at an institution where you think you're going to apply for a position very soon. And if you don't know the author very well personally, you don't know how they handle criticism. It may be, and this I would say is a minority of people, but that's irrelevant. If that one person that's important for you is one of that minority, then this is irrelevant. The statistics are irrelevant. But there are people that get very defensive when their work is criticized. And especially in science, I would say this is even rarer than outside of science, but still it does happen. And so if you don't want to risk your job opportunities at that institution, you don't want to know necessarily right away that this big criticism of the work, in the example above, when you point out that the elephant is not an elephant, but actually a rhinoceros, you may not want to say out loud that this is your name, and then next week you're there, you're interviewing in this institution, and that person sits in the committee. And these things do happen. I have, I know a person firsthand on a committee who heard that a committee member said, this applicant, I think, was one of the reviewers on my grant. I don't want that person to get the job. So these things do happen. And in this particular case that I'm thinking of, that person couldn't even be sure because the reviewer was anonymous. They just thought, this person wrote it in this way, that I'm sure this is this applicant, and this, there's no way I'm going to admit this person to this position. So these, there are examples of these. We don't know how often this happens. I personally also know of a reviewer who once delayed our publication intentionally so that their publication would come out first.
Yeah.
I only know this because I heard it from the editor, but this has happened. We don't know how often it happens, but this is the blessing and the curse of the anonymity in peer review. The blessing is that we can protect people who face or at least fear risks for criticizing powerful, more or less, powerful people or people in powerful positions. And the curse is that you can abuse the anonymity. And this is something that we find, of course, also outside of academia. The anonymity is the blessing so that, for instance, women can speak out about harassers that are in more powerful positions. But it's also a curse because it's very difficult, let me put it this way, it's very difficult to find out if that person is not using the anonymity for nefarious means. And so we need anonymity in many cases, but this necessity of having anonymity also can lead, we don't know when or how often, can lead to people abusing anonymity. And so this is a balance we have to strike. My particular idea for that is, for instance, if you have tenure, you're not allowed to be anonymous anymore in peer review, in academic peer review. Then you should not be able to be anonymous anymore. But then again, this is not as easy. This sounds very easy. Oh, I don't have to fear anything for myself anymore. But in many countries, the people that work in one's lab are dependent on your grant funding. So if your grants don't go through, then these people lose their jobs. So from that perspective, you could already say, okay, if I know this person is on my study section and I'm reviewing their paper, if I'm criticizing them, I may not be risking my job, but I'm risking the jobs of the people working in my lab. So as much as I would wish it would be as easy as that, if you have tenure, no more anonymity, it's unfortunately not that easy.
Could we imagine an alternative that the researcher, instead of passing this long process with journals that can take literally ages to submit, to get comments from peer reviews, to complete with necessary experiments, to pay a few hundred or few thousand euros, and to finally get published? Instead of this, can the researcher publish online his results on his, her personal website or somewhere else for free and fast? In addition, everyone can come, comment, and leave critiques in comments, and therefore it will not feel like the researcher is being too much criticized, while there will be a collective work. As everything will be open, there is no need in anonymity.
It can work, but only if it's done in the right way. So in many communities of the fields of mathematics and physics, they have been doing this since 1991 and before, but digital is since 1991 in the so-called archive, where they place all their manuscripts right after they've written them, I would guess. Many in these fields, or in these fields that are represented on archive, many of them never look at journals anymore. They just work on archive. When I talk to them very often, they say, oh, you and your open access stuff. I don't care about open access. I have archive. Everything's open access. I don't care about journals. But when you then ask, when you talk more with these people, they still publish their articles in journals. And that sounded really weird. And I said, you don't read journals? I said, no, I don't read journals, but I publish them. I publish there. It's like, wait a minute, that's really weird, isn't it? I mean, you publish in journals and neither you nor your colleagues read it. So why do you publish them in the journals when you already have them on archive? And he said, and then they say, oh yes, but I need the publications for my CV so I can have a job or I can get grants. So in physics, it's actually like you say, but the journal system is still there. It's only that very few people read these articles. They're just there so that the physicists and mathematicians have lines on their CV. In fact, if you look at usage data, the archive versions usually get 4 to 5 times as many accesses than the journal versions of these articles. So it's very few people that actually look at the journal articles, and the libraries pay for these journal articles, not for anybody to read them, but so that the scientists can get the lines on their CV, because the content is irrelevant. The content is already out there.
As far as I know, still there is a difference between articles or preprints in archive and articles which are published in commercial journals. They are different in terms of the copyright, because the article in journal is owned and copyrighted by journal, while archive has different, less strict copyrights, which actually belong to the article author.
Yes, this is the case, especially for subscription journals. They usually insist on getting copyright transfer, which is essentially what they use to extort the money from the libraries. Now, this is a practice that has come for many, many years already under increasing scrutiny and critique. And this is probably a situation that won't be around for too much longer, I would guess. It's already receding. But in fact, yes, this journal article then cannot be used in the same way and not be accessed in the same way as this preprint on the archive sites. But if the content is the same or very similar, it doesn't really matter. Because what matters to the physics and math researchers is that they have the line with the publication on their CV. They don't care if anybody can read it or not. And in many cases, if, for all the subscription journals, if the libraries would stop subscribing to all the math and physics journals that where the content is on archive, nobody would notice. They would only notice it when they try to publish there because the journal doesn't exist anymore, because without money, they don't stay around for long.
So it seems that it is more about the scientist mentality. No one wants to be first to do not publish on journals, because in order to get tenures, grants, scientists need to follow the traditional path, which is well established among others, and no one actually cares to make a change there.
So if you want to do it right, what you would have to do is you would shift the finances. So you would say, well, that's one way. I mean, there's many ways of doing it right. One way of doing it right, the way you suggest, is, you know, to publish something and then let everybody scrutinize it, is to provide an infrastructure to do so. So that universities, instead of paying, my university pays about 2 million euros every year in these subscriptions. Instead of putting two million euros per year into subscriptions, put them into an infrastructure that takes care of my data, takes care of my code, and makes it very easy to combine data and code in an interactive way to present my data to the public. And then if I then want to publish it somewhere else, this is my spare time. I can publish it as a book, I can publish it in a journal, I can publish it wherever I want. But that's my private thing. And the university doesn't have to pay for it. So if the publisher says, oh, if you want to publish this paper with us, then you have to pay 5,000 euros. Then the university says, no, you have everything. We provide you with, you know, communicating your research to everybody. Everybody can scrutinize it. Everybody can comment on it. You can cite everything very easily because we use the same system as all the other universities. So you drag and drop your links in there. Everything is much easier for you to use this system. If you then want to publish it somewhere else in addition, that's fine, but that's your private thing. That's not our obligation to pay for that. And that way you don't force anybody to use that system. You just say, okay, look, we pay for it, and if this is what you want to use, then this is fine. If you don't want to use it, well, we paid for everything else is up to you.
This was the third part of four of our interview with Björn Brands. The traditional academic publishing seems to be inefficient nowadays. It is long, controversial, and certainly not perfect. It is fully controlled by commercial journals, private and public. They are making trends in current research and creating artificial scientific prestige, more about which you will learn in our last fourth episode. I would like to ask you to support our project by subscribing to our channel, by liking, commenting, and sharing this and other videos among your friends, colleagues, and family. Thank you. Bye. See you soon.